great to be here, and it's amazing to see so many familiar faces, both participants who have joined us and families. So thank you so much for contributing to the research to help us understand more about all the kids that we want to support better. So what I'm going to talk about, we'll cover a couple of topics. It's a perfect transition from the amazing presentation we just heard. I want to share with you a bit of insight onto what reading is, how we break it down, how we understand it. I want to talk a little bit about how the brain supports reading in particular, and then I'll talk about what the knowledge base is about struggling readers, including children with hemispherectomy, what we know about their reading skills, and for assessments, what kinds of pieces would you want to see in reports for professionals who work with your kids in a clinical setting. And then I think we'll have enough time for questions afterwards, so I really welcome any insights or questions that you might have. So just to get us started, I want to just get us on the same page, just thinking about any time you're thinking about listening or seeing, for a language, you want to think about receptive or expressive capacities as well. So there's always four skills we want to think about. Never just reading in isolation, but reading in a larger context of the other skills that are the counterparts. So if we think of information that's visual and receptive, so it's coming into my system, that's reading. If I'm thinking of something that's visual and I'm putting it out into the world, expressive, that's writing. And if I think of it in the auditory domain, what's coming into me in the auditory domain, that's listening. That's the receptive skill I have. And when I'm expressive, that's my speaking skill. So part of what a good clinician will do will be to contextualize reading in this broader framework of the skills that are available and this kind of core piece. And I'm going to have some transitions from a very simple model to make it a little bit more complex. I'm also very happy to share slides and articles that I'll reference afterwards. So in case you miss anything, I'll be very happy to pass that along. So I'm going to teach you an acronym that's very helpful to me. The acronym is POSSUM. Misspelled, I know that as a reading person, don't worry. Prepared for that responsibility. But it's a very helpful way to remember some really important ways to break down what language entails. So I'm going to review each one to give you some definitions and some descriptions. But just to give you an overview, when we think about language that's related to oral and to written elements, you want to think about the elements of phonology, pragmatics, orthography, semantics, syntax, and morphology. So I said all those quickly. I'm going to walk through each one, give you definitions, and repeat them. So the first one we'll think about is phonology. I'll start off with the fun part, which is the cartoon here. In case you can't see it, it says, sorry, I was looking for valet parking. So hopefully that seems funny. The reason it should seem funny is because this guy's looking like he's about to do valet, right? So valet, the error there is in the perception of the sound. And the basis for language and the basis for reading does not start so much in the visual domain, but in the auditory domain. That means you have to be able to perceive the sounds of language in a way that's meaningful, accurate, sequential, and precise, before you can then map that system onto these squiggles on a page that we all agree are the letters we're going to use. Okay, so phonology is defined as the rules governing the sounds of language. Phonology skills include things like rhyming, like being able to match different sounds, by being able to take letters that are separate and blend them together, or to remember words with precision. So phonology is one of the most important foundational skills for reading. Because it is demonstrative of your ability to master how sounds come together and how you can manipulate them. Okay, so then we have the next one, P for pragmatics. No fun cartoon, but I'm sure you can think of lots of great examples here. Pragmatics, that's defined as the rules governing the use of language and how you communicate. So a couple of examples. It includes how you use language for different purposes, for greeting, for requesting, for informing. How you change your language depending on if you're talking to a child or an adult or a peer, or if you're adapting to someone's background knowledge, if they need more or less. And also it includes following rules for conversations, telling stories, taking turns, using your facial expression or reading someone else's, or staying on topic. So I know for many of you this is a domain that you may or not have experience with on your IEPs, or recognizing it as essential as the remaining ones as something that's important to have attention to. Okay, so we covered the two P's. Now we're up to the O for orthography. So can everyone just read what that says down there? The cat. It says the cat, and you are correct. Great reading skills there. And I hope you can notice that the middle letter in both of those words is exactly the same. Right, so we have a letter that we read as an H in the. The same letter is in the middle of C and T, but we read it as an A. And that's your ability to be flexible with the written print of language and use context to help interpret what those symbols should mean in different places. So orthography is defined as the rules governing the written symbols of a language. So for our alphabet, orthography dictates why we don't usually see a Z and a G together, but we often see a T and an H together. So this is a really core skill for our spelling, but also for our reading, because it's what allows us to know which sounds and which letters go together. And in English, there is not a one-to-one relationship between letters and sounds like other languages such as Spanish may have. That means A can make many sounds, and sound A can be written down in many ways. So there's not a one-to-one relationship. It's a much harder system to work with compared to other kinds of languages. So for kids, the flexibility in learning the rules that govern orthography are another core foundational skill for literacy. Okay, so for our next letter, S for semantics. So semantics are the rules governing the meanings of words. Now this is not just how words are defined. It includes any associations you might have with words, multiple meanings they may have. So if I say the word jam, you might think of your breakfast and what you put on toast. You might think of a music jam session. Some of you may unfortunately think of a traffic jam. All of the ways in which all of the associations you have with a particular word are really powerful for kids, because the rule of thumb is, the more you know about a word, the faster you can retrieve it. So a lot of interventions for reading actually train kids on having a lot of associations built up for particular words that are important for their vocabulary. If you think of this word, what else does it make you think of? Can you tag on a lot of associations so that there's a lot of access points to go in and get that word later when you need it? And that thinking can be either in oral language or for reading. And so this cartoon here says, they complimented your driving. It says parking fine. So this is a great example of how fine, this word has multiple meanings. And he interprets it one way, and his mom maybe a different way. And here's another entertaining one. This says, Lassie, get help. Lassie gets some help. So happy ending. Okay, so our next S, so we're working our way through P-P-O-S. Our second S is for syntax. Syntax is the rules governing the organization of language. So when you are putting words together in sequence, you are following rules of syntax. So that includes how you sequence and organize language, how you match nouns and verbs, how you use pronouns. And I thought some examples of syntax that's violating the rules that we have might be familiar to some of you. I have met in our assessment sessions many Star Wars fans, and so maybe they would appreciate also. So truly wonderful the mind of a child is. You can understand how that's understandable, but the syntax violates the rules that we use when we communicate. And judge me by my size, do you? But both of those might be appropriate for this conference, so those were handpicked just for today. Okay, so the last letter in our acronym POSSUM, M for morphology. A morpheme is the smallest unit of meaning in a language. So when I refer to myself and I say I, that letter actually is a morpheme because it has a meaning by itself. And if I want to change the word run to running, the ing is a morpheme because it changes the meaning of run. So all these units of meaning in a language help us enhance how we communicate. And so morphology is the rules governing the use of morphemes. So here I have some common types of errors involving morphemes. So my dad drink tea instead of drinks tea, somebody coming instead of somebody's coming, can I finish game instead of the game, etc. So these are the kinds of ways you might pick up on those morphological errors in conversations or observations you might have. And here's another example. So here's a school nurse. She's saying, I'll put some gauze on your cut. And he's saying, it's a small cut, so I think it'll only need one gauze. Okay, so that's like a great example of how developmentally morphology kind of takes its time to tack on in a way that's not overgeneralizing some of the rules that kids might be learning. So we just talked about P-P-O-S-S-M, possum, and I'm going to organize that for you into this framework to help you kind of think more about how all those pieces hang together. So you can think of language as having form, having content, and having use. And so when you want to kind of organize possum further, you can think, okay, when I think of content, I'm referring to semantics. When I think of use, I'm thinking of pragmatics. And when I think of form, I'm thinking of those elements that dictate how you put it together. So that's the phonology, because that's how you put together the sounds, the morphology, how you put together the morphemes, and the syntax, how you put together the words. Okay, and all those pieces overlap. So far, so good? Okay, so I'm going to continue complexifying it a little bit. So the next thing now is I'm going to bring in a figure that helps us expand what we're thinking about. So I talked about possum. And actually, just to think about that, which aspect of possum is missing from this slide? The O. Exactly. O for orthography, because the orthography is the only element specific to written language, because it's about letters and print. The rest of these are important for both oral and language, and orthography is only one unique to written language. So when we think of orthography and all the pieces that it comes with, we can now kind of blow that picture up a bit bigger. So you can think of the ultimate goal of reading is to comprehend what you're reading and to be reading at a pace that supports your comprehension, so to be a fluent reader. So ultimately, that's where you want to end up. But it takes a lot of complex interaction of skills to get there. So those skills we can think of as around language, the language side, language comprehension, and word recognition. So there are two really distinct categories that'll predict your reading outcomes and your reading comprehension. One is, how skilled are you at understanding oral language and using it? And then the other separate skill is, how able are you to look at letters on a page and know what sounds they're matched to? Now, that top category has a lot of elements that go into it. So your language comprehension includes your background knowledge, your vocabulary, how deep and how precise it is, your awareness of syntax and semantics, your ability to reason verbally, to make inferences, understand metaphors, and to just know about literacy knowledge in general. So how do you open a book? How do you use it? That sort of thing. What different genres might include. So as all of those skills become increasingly strategic, you're on your way to becoming a more skilled reader. But that's only with the counterpoint available to you as well. So from the word recognition side, that means you have to be able to have intact phonological awareness. Because that means you're going to be able to break words down if you know the components of language and how to map letters and sounds onto each other. The other way to read is, instead of breaking every single word down, is by remembering them in discrete units. So perhaps when you saw my last name, you had to break it down if you braved to read it all systematically. So that was not a sight word for you. You had to decode it to access it. You had to take your knowledge of sounds, map it onto letters. If you saw your own name, you have seen it enough times that it is now a sight word for you. It is completely automatic. So there are some words that with enough exposure, those get banked into an inventory that you could then access whenever you need to. But in order to learn new words, the skills that are most important for that are being able to decode, because that means you'll have the skills to access any word that's not yet in your inventory. So with these two becoming more automatic and strategic, those are the underlying skills that get kids to be comprehending. What's not here are incredibly important skills that I just need to acknowledge. Attention, executive function, memory, and visual motor and oral motor skills. So I'll just put that aside for a moment, but acknowledge that it's there. Okay, so I'm just kind of continuing to build up your awareness of what it takes to be a reader and what kinds of elements are important that go into reading. And there was an important report that came out of a national reading panel, and these are the five most important elements for reading. So in your assessments that you should be looking for, these are pretty core foundational elements that you want the specialists that work with your kids to be able to speak to. So one is phonemic awareness. That's similar to what I mentioned earlier with engaging with the sounds of language. And just so that you're very comfortable with what exactly that means, we can do a quick activity together. So could you please say the word cowboy?
Cowboy.
Could you please saying cowboy without saying cow?
Cowboy.
Okay, great. Now can you please say the word mixed?
Mixed.
Now can you say mixed without saying k? I will do it with you. Okay, so we have m-e-k-s-t. Okay, so now we have m-e-s-t. Missed. Okay, so what I hope you found was that that was harder. Okay, and what you had to do for that example was to not rely on the letters, but only rely on the sounds, and parse the speech stream, remove a distinct piece, and then re-blend it together. That's the kind of activity that we sample when we're looking for phonological processing, because we're looking for facility with using the sounds of language and being able to be flexible with those. Okay? Phonics is now taking the sounds of language and mapping those on the letters of language. Reading fluency, vocab, and comprehension, I think, are more straightforward. So I'll leave that there. So I'm going to transition a little bit and talk to you about how the elements I just reviewed are supported with brain functioning. So this is a schematic that helps us just start, get oriented for those readers who are typically developing. We most often refer to reading development in the left hemisphere. It's not because reading is not important in terms of how the right hemisphere supports it, but I tend to think of how in typical development, the right hemisphere has a huge role in what I think of as the artistry of language. So when you use your voice to emphasize something, when you're sarcastic, when you're making jokes, when you're using hyperbole or irony, any way in which you're kind of adding that the sprinkle of artistry to language, the right hemisphere has a huge role in that. But a lot of reading research heavily relies on studying the left hemisphere because that's a core region for a lot of core language functions, and also a lot of what I talked about before with decoding skills are tend to be left lateralized. So this is a general swath of what is involved for reading. You can see in the frontal lobe, executive function, a little bit behind that speech, a little bit behind that auditory processing, and then the visual piece and the integration of language into the visual information. Now I'm going to make that a little simpler for you. But first I'm going to show you this might be my favorite slide of the talk, so it might be downhill after this, but I think we'll enjoy this in the meantime. So I just want to show you what a brain looks like when it's reading. This is a typically developing reader reading a single word as an adult. And I want you to just appreciate how much of it, how much of the brain is involved. Okay, so you can see these huge swaths of activity throughout the brain. I'll try and put it one more time. This is the left hemisphere, yes, just the left hemisphere. So you can see a lot of it's activated. There's a bit of back recognition in the visual cortex and kind of washing forward and so forth. And now each of those regions that are coming up, I'm gonna simplify it to kind of explain how each of those plays a role. So if we think of the core, yes, another question?
Were they reading out loud or just like looking at it and reading it?
They're reading a single word out loud.
Okay.
Yeah. How did they do that? So there are three main networks in the reading brain for typical readers. We think of the anterior system, which just means front, and then two posterior systems. You may have learned the word dorsal and ventral. I'll remind you in case you haven't. I think of a fish, and a dorsal fin is on top, so I think of dorsal as upper, and vent, I think of gills, which are underneath, so I think of that as bottom. So these three core systems are interactive and part of a larger network. The frontal system has a lot to do with motor production, processing unfamiliar words, and those posterior systems, the dorsal system is heavily driving your decoding skills. So when you're seeing letters and you're trying to think of how they sound, or when trying to spell, that's the system that's supporting it. And when you recognize words, like your own last name, you're building off a part in the visual system that we're thinking of as the posterior ventral. So this is kind of helping to also parse out when you decode, you're relying a lot on the dorsal. When you're recognizing, you're relying a lot on the ventral. And so when we think of reading disability, the most common one that people have researched is dyslexia. So as a counterpoint, I'll just share with you what we know about dyslexia and then relate that to hemispherectomy. Dyslexia being the most common reading disability, we know that it's neurobiological in origin, and it's defined very specifically as being as having difficulties in the accuracy or fluency of single word reading. That means that you can see words in isolation and have a lot of trouble either being accurate in how you're reading them, or you can read them accurately but be extremely slow and not know how to kind of be more efficient or faster in doing so. And a lot of the difficulty in dyslexia is attributed to difficulty with phonology. So that sound system we did before with, we did cowboy and then we said mixed, right? So those are the examples we're thinking of. Those core skills that you want in using the sounds of language, if they're impoverished in some way, there's going to be difficulties in mapping that system onto print. If you cannot access words easily, then a common challenge is in reading comprehension. For dyslexia, you can never look at a brain scan and know if somebody has dyslexia or not, so it's only diagnosable from assessments. So the signature in the brain of dyslexia is you tend to have hyper or more activation in the frontal lobe, and you tend to have relatively less activation in both of the posterior systems. So that means the dorsal and ventral system are relatively less activated, and that makes sense because in dyslexia, what's hard for kids? Decoding and recognizing words, and which systems help support those skills? The dorsal and the ventral system. The other really interesting part about dyslexia is not only are these the characteristics, but in addition, the right hemisphere is activated in the homologous or parallel regions as we see in the left. So those posterior systems are not only type O or less activated in the left hemisphere, but they're also activated in the right, and you do not see that typical reading. So one interesting transition point then is a recent publication that we have for hemispherectomy. So we worked with some of the students some time ago, and we asked the question, what's the maximum capacity of the right hemisphere to support reading and language? In dyslexia, people talk a lot about the right hemisphere, but they always refer to it as compensatory without really having a good understanding of what does that mean? What exact functions can it parallel? What exactly can it offer? Is there a ceiling to how much it can do compared to the left hemisphere? All of those, to my knowledge, are not well established or well understood. So one way we went about trying to understand that is thinking about kids who only have a right hemisphere and understanding, taking into account the complex medical history, can we get a sense of what their skill sets end up being? So that's what we did. And we were interested, we already knew from previous work that the right hemisphere has the potential to sustain ability and to improve ability. And so I'll share with you some of the data so we'll get to the good stuff first. So the first thing is here, in this study we published information comparing those with hemispherectomy, those with left hemispherectomy, and a matched group of kids with dyslexia. So those with hemispherectomy are in the blue, those with dyslexia are in the red. And the first thing you might notice is there are, for example, a couple of categories where there's not that much difference between those with a half a brain and those with a full brain, those with the hemispherectomy and those with dyslexia. There are extremely different mechanisms and pathways that lead to the performance. But for some of these categories, including timed real word reading and timed pseudo word reading, there were not significant differences between the groups. The really interesting thing that we then also, let me just finish describing this, which is our samples were quite small for obvious reasons, but you can see, you can't see if it's cut off, but on the y-axis, the word ID, so reading real words, those with hemispherectomy were hovering just below 80, so our average range is 85 to 115. And those with dyslexia were hovering around just around 80. And then there's not that much difference between reading real words and reading made-up words for those with hemispherectomy, but a little bit of an improvement for those with dyslexia. And passive comprehension was an issue for both groups. The interesting thing was we took that exact group, but instead of showing the hemispherectomy group compared to those with dyslexia, we broke it up by kids who had either an early or a late insult. Okay, so it's the same exact hemispherectomy group, but now broken up. So the dark blue is early insult, the light blue is late insult, and now you can see that that average really was capturing the exact middle ground of where each of the groups was originally. So now we're seeing, for example, that the kids who had early insult from the hemispherectomy group are trending to show stronger performance than the kids who had late, but also those who have dyslexia. So this is a really interesting way to think about how is that possible. And the particular tasks I'm highlighting are timed word reading. That means, so many of you may have the experience of working with your kids and thinking that timed pieces are much harder and you avoid that, and untimed is much better, and that's the strategy. And this again is a compilation of lots of individual data, but there's an interesting hypothesis that's come out of the work, which is in some cases, for some of the kids we worked with who have had the hemispherectomy, it could be possible that the timed element adds something that you can't get otherwise, which is it forces the system to be productive in a way that without time pressure, you might not get the same performance. So put another way, when we think about the general processing of left hemisphere and right hemisphere, one rule of thumb people think about is the left hemisphere can be more detail-oriented and part-oriented, and the right hemisphere can be more whole-oriented, so forest for the trees as opposed to the trees for the forest. So if you only have a right hemisphere, one strategy that you might be capitalizing on is reading words at a more holistic level. I'm also realizing I have to find how to plug this in because my battery's about. Sorry about that, I thought I plugged it already. Who had early insult, so before age three, most of them in utero. And so the first category that's a little cut off there is receptive vocabulary. So I say a word, you point to one or four pictures, show me which picture showed that idea. Reading real words, that's what word idea is. Reading made up words, that's what word attack is. And then doing each of those in a timed way. So timed real word reading, timed made up word reading, and the last category is reading comprehension. So you can get a sense that there's lots of scatter. There are a lot of really different profiles where those skills can end up being. One thing that you might take note of is that some of these kids, if you're comparing the untimed word reading to the timed word reading, for a lot of these kids, that timed word reading actually is a little bit elevated compared to the untimed word. And that's a bit of what I was referencing before about how the right hemisphere might have a proclivity to this whole versus part processing that's supporting it. And when you're in a timed context, you don't have time to either second guess yourself or to force yourself to use a decoding strategy or to take your time and second guess or really, really think a word through. If it's available in your inventory, whether you have confidence that it's there or not, it's coming out. And so that's kind of one way we're hypothesizing the explanation there. So this is the early incel cases, and these are the late ones. So again, on the axis, which you can't see, so sorry about that, the lowest, the axis starts at 50 and it goes up until 110. So a lot of these scores are kind of really hovering in the 50 to 70 range. But you also see some of these kids have that same pattern with the timed word reading having some elevation above the untimed word reading that I think parallels what we had just seen. Okay, any questions or otherwise so far? For those of you who have come for the reading study and assessment while we've been here with the team, a lot of these are the kinds of assessments that we've done with your kids that we're looking forward to giving you scores before the end of the summer. Sure. I'm happy to send all of these slides. Yeah, absolutely. I'll send them to Monica or... Perfect, yeah. Yes?
Do you think all these kids were stroke?
These kids were. Yeah, all of these were in utero, and then all of these were breast mucus encephalitis.
I think it was
this
paper, we tried to get data on HIV and perhaps Huntington, and it was the IRB to confirm the IRB
viewers.
You have too many different kids, different underlying etiologies, and they get one etiology.
Yeah. Okay, so what I want to transition to make sure we cover as well is this assessment piece. So I'm now going to revisit some of the concepts we started off with when I talked about what goes into reading. I follow that up with showing you how the brain supports those kinds of skills. I have a little bit about what we've learned so far about kids with hemispherectomy. So this is going to be hopefully insightful for whatever you're reviewing reports or working with clinicians who are going to be working with your child. And I have to say one of the most incredibly helpful things that those of the families I've worked with this time through has been is that no one knows your child better than you, obviously, and your insights about what how to optimize or really support them in the testing session is really invaluable. And I hope that's something that you continue to communicate with people who get the privilege of working with your kids. So first I'll share that assessment is not the same as testing. Testing is just giving a set of questions to get a score. Assessment is combining data from multiple sources. So that includes observations, parent reports, the test themselves, and professional judgment. And so we think of this kind of four pillars of assessments. You have norm reference tests. That means that there are norms that you can then translate a raw score to an age or grade-based comparison. Interviews with the teachers or parents, observations in the classroom, and informal assessments. So all of these might be pieces of data that go into a diagnostic eval for your child. Qualitative observations should be in a report. So that means that any report should not just have scores. It's incredibly important to complement quantitative information with qualitative. So what does that mean? You should have a sense, I'll just put all these out, what kinds of strategies or problem-solving approaches were used for different tasks. What was the persistence, the flexibility, or the frustration tolerance like? How easy was it for someone to give up and under what circumstances? Does using multiple choice improve or make performance worse? Is there a difference on expressive tasks versus receptive tasks? Do errors appear to be because of inattention or impulsivity? Do certain tests seem especially effortful or stressful? And are there some tasks that might elicit enthusiasm or enjoyment or withdrawal or reluctance? So getting a sense for how the qualitative piece is for any given assessment is as important as the numbers themselves, because that'll really be able to inform practice as well. And just to give you a sense, some of this might be quite familiar. Whenever we are doing testing, there are a couple of numbers that are going to be essential for your understanding. We get raw scores, but they are never useful in their raw form. So if I just tell you for a given test a child got 15, that doesn't mean anything, right? So it's not interpretable. So what you're going to be interested in is the interpretable scores. One of them is a standard score. The standard score I mentioned a little bit already, it's probably the most widely used, has an average range of 85 to 115 most often. And some manuals vary in what they're categorizing as average, below average, or otherwise. Another number that's going to be very important is the percentile rank. So relative to the norm group, what it tells you what percentage of people in the norm group performed more poorly than the individual. And probably, I think, most relevant for this group is to think of age and grade equivalents. So these will be, they're referred to as a hypothesized average score of children in a particular age or grade level. So if someone has an age equivalent or an AE of 5-6, that means their performance was commensurate with a typical student of 5 years, 6 months. If someone has a grade equivalent or a GE of 6-1, that would mean their performance was commensurate with the child in the first month of sixth grade. Okay. What kind of elements would be really important in assessment? So these are some of the highlights that I thought might be useful. One is getting information on general cognitive abilities. Now, for a lot of kids who have a very scattered profile, what would be important is to not look at composite scores or scores that collapse across subtests, but instead to look at individual subtests themselves. Because when you have a child with a very varied profile, anytime you're looking at a composite or a combination across subtests, you're really missing and obscuring information that might be quite useful. So I would just caution against that piece. Another piece that we'll, so we'll walk through each of these, but phonology is what I mentioned earlier. There are many standardized assessments of phonological processing, and those really are going to be a hugely helpful predictor of reading capacity. One task that we'll review now will be rapid automatized naming, or RAN. We'll practice that one in a minute. And then I mentioned when we started that reading should always be in the context of language. It's just one of those four quadrants. So a reading evaluation should include the kinds of skills that you're building off of to read, your core language skills. So measuring vocabulary and language use understanding are incredibly important. And then when you measure word reading, there are four dimensions that are important. Measuring real words, measuring made-up words, and then timed and untimed. Because that comparison across those four is very revealing for someone's skill set as well. And then there's reading comprehension. So just walking through each of these categories a bit, one common test you might see is the Wechsler Intelligence Scale for Children, or the WISC. And it breaks down cognitive abilities into these categories: verbal comprehension, visual spatial, working memory, fluid reasoning, processing speed. Describe each of those is not so relevant right now, but I think as a baseline, those skills are important to document and to not obscure so much in the composites. It's just an example to show you. So you would see, you'd say the top figure goes with the one next to it, just like which one of these goes with the bottom figure. So you're doing a lot of these visual analogies. This is one way that people measure nonverbal IQ. So it does not require a language processing, so except for the light directions. It's a lot of pattern recognition. The WISC and other tests like it will help identify key strengths and weaknesses that are related to learning, executive function, and attention. And no literacy skills are required, so none of these involve reading. And for any child, there's always going to be relative strengths and weaknesses. That means for anyone who's getting an assessment done, a clinician should be able to tell you not everything has a deficit, but how those deficits are what the counterparts are as strengths. And the strengths don't have to be the ones that are very high scores. It could be that there are lots of low scores, but relatively speaking, strengths and weaknesses should always be identified within any profile. Phonology I mentioned earlier, so I'll just reference that and just keep going. And rapid naming, so this is an activity we'll do together really quickly. So I'm gonna invite you to take a look at this. You can start in the far left and read across each row as quickly as you can without making any mistakes. So I'll invite you to start, I'll count down from three. Ready? 3, 2, 1. Environment, but what you just did was you looked at abstract visual stimuli on a page, and you sequentially, in the same way that you read from left to right, top to bottom, you analyzed them, you perceived them, you named them, you articulated it, you shifted, you went to the next one, and you did that repeatedly throughout. So this is a really predictive assessment of reading, because it's said to parallel the same exact sorts of skills in a much simplified, in a much more simplified way, what you have to do if you're reading text. So phonology and rapid naming, or RAN tasks, are two of the core component skills that people look for predicting reading outcomes. And it's also another one of the most common deficits for those with dyslexia. Okay, so I had mentioned earlier that you would want to also have word reading for real words and for made-up words, both in timed and untimed contexts. So a common assessment people might use is a Wolcott Reading Mastery Test. And for the timed reading, a common test that's often used is the test of word reading efficiency. So here's an example of that one. So you can see on the left is real words, on the right is made-up words. And so I need you to start at the top and read down the list as fast as you can without making mistakes. So let's do the real words. Ready, begin. Okay, now let's try the made-up words. So ready, do it as fast as you can without making mistakes. Begin. Okay, so that's what the kids go through as well, and that gives a sense of this automaticity piece. So you don't have time to second check yourself, you don't have time to decode, you're just kind of pushing through. So in a way, it's almost bypassing what might feel like roadblocks otherwise to kind of reveal what's in there when you kind of pressure the system to see what's in there to get it out. And then past comprehension can be measured in a whole range of ways. One example is that people read a sentence that has a missing part. You have to fill in the blank, essentially. So an example is taken from the same measure I talked about earlier, the WRT, passage comprehension subtest. Vocab is incredibly important. So this is the kind of task where you're shown four pictures, and I might say bicycle, and you have to point to the bicycle. So that's a task we're using today when we're doing our assessments that gives us a baseline for receptive vocabulary. And then another example of oral language tasks might be, I'm going to say a sentence, and I want you to repeat when I finished. When I finish, so I run. The assignment was 14 pages long in the red blue book before. That doesn't even make sense. Yeah, they always make sense. So yeah, that's not a good example, but you can imagine what the rest of that would be like if it was earlier in the day. And I got all of that out. Okay, so that's kind of the example there. So the goal is, can you perceive all of it, hold on to it, remember it, and then repeat it back in a precise, systematic way? And if you can't, are you holding on to the meaning, or is everything just falling apart? So those kinds of assessments are helpful for revealing all those elements of how language is processed. So I'm going to pause here, and so we can have some time for the panel discussion and some questions that come through from you. And the headlines I would love for you to walk away with are thinking that reading abilities can be understood in the context of cognitive and language skills, that reading abilities can really be thought of as having component skills and phonology and rapid naming, and then you can think of outcome skills in word reading, comprehension, and writing, and that's one way you can think about what's in assessments and if they've been covered, and that these component skills are incredibly good predictors of reading skills. And insights into these areas will be really helpful for formulating the best kinds of educational approaches for the kids. So thank you to the participants and families in these studies and this visit, to lab members and to the NSF and NIH who are supporting our work. Diagnosed in the presence of something else that could explain their difficulty. So dyslexia is a challenge in single word reading, but it's often not given as a diagnostic label when there's a more dominant frame of reference that can be helpful. That doesn't mean that you would not earn on an IEP the labels that are helpful. So dyslexia is actually a term that's most often used in the research world, and if you think of what clinicians use, they use the a manual called the DSM. And if you think of what educators use, they use IDEA. So the federal law that obligates you to get services in a school setting would not say dyslexia. Instead, the parallel term is specific learning disability. And then that category has six options. So if your child is getting reading services in a school, most likely they have an SLD categorization. And then the six categories, one of the first one is essentially parallel to reading, dyslexia, which is single word level deficit. The second category is reading comprehension. The third and fourth are about math, so one about math computation and one about math reasoning. And the last two are writing related. One is about spelling, one is about written expression. So on IEPs, in education context, the relevant term that people need to use, because that's what gets you services, is specific learning disability. And then people then subcategorize into one of the six categories that are published. Entirely true. So if you wanted to think of the most productive community partnership to think of resources that would be beneficial, the dyslexia world, I think for sure, is a huge one. The dyslexia world has an organization in almost every state. So local state branches of the International Dyslexia Association have a really helpful resource, which is you should, if you check in your state to see if you have a branch, and if not, then you'll have one close by, they almost always offer a free or for the $20 membership, free consultation on IEPs, free recommendations for clinicians who can do evaluations in your area, free referrals to local places to get intervention services. The International Dyslexia Association, and we put together a resource page that we have been giving out to families who have visited us, but I'm happy to also email that out so you all have it. So the International Dyslexia Association, or IDA, has a branch in almost every state, and that's a great resource for directly talking to the board members for referrals or consultations, and also for accessing resources regarding exactly what kind of interventions are available and which ones might be a good fit.
Thank you.
Welcome. Other questions? Yes.
So it seemed like most of the analysis is on the left hemi or the left stroke. How about that? Have you thought about
Well, we just are finishing data collection right now. So what we're doing now, so we invited families who had their situation, and we'll be looking forward to just actually having the counterbalance to understand both communities and see what we can learn about how they compare.
Yeah.
I hope with our next paper, because of your participation in the research that we were here for, that can change. Yeah, we're really eager to offer as much information as we can. And it's all because of you bringing your kids to us and them joining us. And is there a specific program you can recommend? So one thing I will say is without knowing the individual kids, it would not be a helpful recommendation because it should be based on each kid, each child, and what context their performance is in, both cognitively and with their language skills. But one thing I will say is one hypothesis that I was referring to before, that for some of the kids who only have the right hemisphere, if it's true that they may be benefiting from an approach that's a bit more whole versus part oriented, what that translates to for instruction is supporting their recognition of words in bigger chunks, or being able to visualize words in a way that they can access, and that's in contrast to approaches intervention-wise that would be more always decoding based. So that's really dyslexia, it's a parallel story because you're balancing intervention that teaches kids to decode every word with intervention that supports kids with recognizing words and building their sight word vocabulary. So for example, a program like Linda Moon Bell's Seeing Stars supports this kind of visualizing words and kind of increasing the chunk size of the words themselves. It's it's going to be worthwhile to help kids be able to decode, because that means they have access to new words across the board. But in particular cases, given different kinds of strengths or weaknesses, considering supporting this potential strength with kind of the more chunk-oriented recognition pieces, that might be something that could be helpful. Yes? Email address. Yes, I will tell you. It's the shortest one. Don't spell my last name for this one. Is my initials JAC and the number 765 at mail.harvard.edu. I think, let me see if I can get this back up for you.
Does anyone else have some questions? Go ahead.
It's something you probably can't answer, and I'm hoping you can maybe just give me a generic guess. Okay, my daughter has never read. She's 10. When she was 4, she knew most of the alphabet, could count. And seizures got bad. When she had surgery, she knew no letters, no numbers. She's now learning letters and numbers again, albeit 2 years, and we're still working on up to 10 and stuff like that. So do you have an opinion, and I know it's only an opinion, on if she may ever read? Again, she's 10 years old now.
I don't know that I'm in a position to answer that.
As an opinion?
I will say that what that makes me think of is for a lot of times when we work clinically with kids who have a lot of trouble just accessing that text-speech relationship, that letter-sound correspondence, one thing we think about, especially as they get older, is giving them functional literacy skills. And that's a different direction than trying to support them with the more core literacy skills that you start off with for lots of other kids in early elementary school. So if you go more of a functional literacy approach, what you're doing is giving them skills that you anticipate will help them navigate the world with some independence and some safety. But it's very much focused on things that will be practically helpful in a very concrete way.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a question.
Sure. I think all the experts for that question are among you. You know, because each of you who have gone through that experience will be able to speak to that concretely to say, in our situation, you know, I talked with some parents and some people shared right as soon as they woke up, they were speaking, and that was a surprise and a welcome one, and others who had different stories. I don't have any insights that would be science-based. And I think at this point, I'm not sure who knows how to predict outcomes. And I think the physicians and the surgeons and the families who have gone through it have more authentic, real-world experience that I don't have about that.
I'm going to stick my neck out a little bit, and I'm going to say he may read great. He may have some issues, or he may have some significant issues, or he may not read. So I think you hope for the best, prepare for the worst, and use our resources afterwards. We'll all do our very best to push him as far as possible, but I don't think there's an answer or a crystal ball, unfortunately, to know for sure.
What I think would be amazing is, to my knowledge, I don't think that there's a lot of assessment before the surgery. In terms of academic skills, to my knowledge, I think that's, you know, there's so many other complicated medical pieces that have people's attention. One of my research wish list items would be to have assessments done in kids before, and then you have a comparison to think about after. And I can imagine numbers going in all sorts of directions because the seizures may have been inhibiting learning, and memory and so forth, and you can see going any which direction. So. The question is, what grade level is considered functionally literate? I would say aiming for, well, so we're in the elementary school age range, and it's requiring that you can recognize basic words. I would say the upper limit of a functional literacy level might be fourth grade. Okay, so that'd be if you can get a child to a fourth grade level, that would be a great place for them. They'd be able to navigate a lot of information that they'd be exposed to in the world. And then wherever they may fall before that, wherever, you know, aim for that and then see how things go. In the public school setting, the best person to do a reading assessment, it ends up, I guess the answer ends up being who is doing it in a school. And I guess the most likely person is usually a school psychologist. So those of you who have been in school settings have other people done it. Sometimes a speech-language pathologist might do it. So I guess what you want to have is someone who understands reading. Some speech-language pathologists also have been trained in literacy, but it's not common. So an ideal situation would be an SLP who has done also literacy training, who can then understand the language and literacy and how they interact. That would be one really ideal approach. Another would be a school psychologist who has studied and understood reading disabilities. And even if it's not hemispherectomy, at least understanding reading development and atypical development and how to understand it. Do you mean in particular or in general? In general.
Yeah, in general, I'm more interested in those.
Yeah, so the question is, do testers or people doing the assessments accommodate for the compromised visual field perception, right? So one thing that we have learned every time a family came to work with us was included in their description of what might be best for their child, exactly how to orient things and position things so the child can perceive them. We did a very gentle visual test in our part of our assessment in the settings where you're getting clinical evals. I think that is absolutely essential to educate people on what to do and how to do it. A lot of people, majority, will not have experience working with kids that this community includes. And I think sharing your expertise on exactly what works for them, including the visual piece, is a very easy way to support them. That's it. Yeah, so in terms of additional accommodations or otherwise, because we want to understand how they might function on other kinds of activities or contexts, assessment tries to replicate what you might be seeing in lots of other places. So unless there's some way in which everything in their visual field is going to be changed in some way, using assessments that are going to be similar to what they might experience if they walk outside the room is one way to help know what it will take and how they'll be functioning in the real world setting. So that's one explanation to think about. Not adapting it in a very extreme way is actually a good way to make sure you're getting a sense of how they might function when they step outside the room. Is there a question over here?
Last question, one more.
Okay, so a great question. So what insight is it possible that kids might benefit from reading top to bottom as opposed to left to right? And there's a really nice parallel from the dyslexia world that speaks to this. So one study has found that those who have dyslexia struggle with print. And one technological intervention that's quite useful and affordable and easy to implement is, you know, if you were to look at a tablet, you have quite a number of words on a given line of text. And so one study showed that if you restrict how many words are on a line to about three, and it's a scrolling thing, right? So it's okay that you don't have to have everything printed out paper to do this with reams of paper, but if on a technological device you restrict the range of the number of words on a page to about three per line, one thing that was found in the dyslexia world is that it really helped kids improve their accuracy and their comprehension. And that might be a really nice translation for the dyslexia world to explore with the kids here, because instead of having to change everything about the words, instead you're restricting it to, in a way that's possible for whatever works for them. And for those who are interested in how to access that or how to actually do that, I can share with you the article and the colleague who's developing the app for that, so in case that might be of interest to you.
Thank you.
So I'll send that to Monica as well. There, yeah. So many of you are already doing that, it sounds like. Yeah. I think the app has several options for font style, the font size. I think the app also has the option for it to be read to you, should that be helpful. So I'd be very happy to share that as well.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.